Across North and South America and around the world, you're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper.
And I'm Pooh. And I'm Pooh.
You sure are. She didn't fall asleep on me tonight, folks. I gotta tell you something. Boy, the man upstairs got even with me today. Annie's Chinese, and there's a good Chinese restaurant in Sholo. So we had to do some business over there. I took Annie and Pooh to the Chinese restaurant, and we sat down to eat, and they have these placemats on the tables. And they're the Chinese horoscope. And the way it works is they have these 12 animals, and you find your year under the animal that you belong to, and then you read the little paragraph that tells you what your personality is supposed to be like according to the animal. And I went looking for my year, which is 1943, and the dear sheeple, you'll be happy to know that my animal was the sheep. Thought you might like that. Well, we've got a real informative program laid out for you tonight. Make sure you have pen and paper by your side and listen carefully. He went to get the sheriff. Let's see him down here behind this table. You stay over there, Pooh. Get behind the bar. God, the smoke's all over. I can't see anything. Can you see anything, Pooh?
No.
Uh-oh. It's all quiet. I still can't see through the smoke. Uh-oh. Stay down. Stay down, Pooh. Just seen a guy just roll right down the stairs. Don't move. Uh-oh. There goes another one. Oh, Oh, no. He's coming this way. Oh, Lord, don't let him come over here. I'm trying to see through the smoke. Boy, this is one mean hombre. I wish I could see what's going on. I don't know who it is. Oh, here he comes. Smoke's clearing. Light's coming through the window. Oh, hallelujah! It's Sheriff Mack. Welcome to the Hour of the Time.
Thanks a lot, Bill.
Well, you've become a real hero to a lot of people. I think I told you last time, and it's...
That's quite an introduction, I tell you.
Well, we tried to do it a little entertaining and hit a lot of serious subjects on here, so you got to have a laugh once in a while.
Well, I'm convinced of that. If you can't laugh and keep your sense of humor, then I say it's about time to check it in. But I have a good wife and family that keep me in stitches all the time.
That's great. Well, what's happened since the last time that you paid us a visit?
Oh, my gosh. It seems like it was just about a month ago that we talked last, wasn't it?
Yeah, it wasn't very long.
And it seems during that time I've had a lifetime of things happen to me. We got a lot to talk about, and I think that was your little daughter, Pooh?
Yeah, that's Pooh.
Oh, she sounds darling, and it reminded me, my little fifth grader came home just the other night, and I guess she's been studying the Constitution at school, which really thrilled me. And she came home and she said, "Dad, look what we learned at school." And she showed me this piece of paper, and it had the Second Amendment on it. And she says, "This is what you're doing, huh? This is what you're fighting for, huh?" And I said, "Yes, it is, Mandy." And she asked me to tell her about it, and she said, "What does infringe mean?" And I told her what infringe means. She goes, "Well, Dad, isn't a 5-day waiting period one of those? Wouldn't that be a kind of infringing?" And I said, "Yeah, it would, Mandy." And she said, "Why does our government do that?" And I said, "That's the exact question that I and a lot of other people are asking them, and that's why I'm doing this, because I promised the people that voted for me that I would stand up for the Constitution and that I would ask these questions to the government if it ever happened." And she says, "Dad, I'm glad you're doing that."
Well, you know, this country was made by that kind of men and women, and it doesn't seem like there's any left anymore except a few.
Yeah, very few. And then I started asking, I want to ask the Janet Renos and the Sarah Bradys and any other congressman or any other person in this country that supports gun control in any manner to explain to their fifth graders or their young children that waiting periods, that registrations, that the 20,000 gun control laws we have in America already, how those would not be infringements upon our rights. And I'd really like them to be able to do that, to where a person that's just learning about what the word infringed means and what the Constitution is about and how they could logically and morally try to justify gun control when the Constitution, especially from a historical perspective, if you teach your young child about how our country was formed and about how it was good, honest American people who were able to defend our liberties against the King of England, and now we have a new King of England called Washington, D.C. bureaucracy, and how, if you look at it from that perspective, from the history and from the origination of our country and the origination of our Constitution, how you could describe this to a young student and tell them with a clear conscience that the gun control laws we have in America today are not a violation of our Constitution or our rights. I don't think it can be done. I honestly don't.
I don't think so either, and I don't think that anybody's going to get those people to address that particular issue, because in our study we find them to be screaming Marxists, and Marxists don't want Americans to have guns because they're pulling us into this socialist New World Order.
Well, that's just right-wing paranoia. Didn't you know that?
Well, that's what they keep telling me.
Yeah, that's what they're telling me, too. I don't know if you knew this. I was on Good Morning America last Tuesday, 9 days ago, with Sarah Brady.
Yeah, I knew you were on there, but I didn't get to watch it because I didn't know beforehand. I found out after the fact. What happened?
Well, you didn't miss a lot. I felt basically that it was somewhat fair. I didn't like the fact that I had to speak first. And then she got to follow up and kind of respond to what I had said.
Yeah, that's called the, that's called you put it out and we tear you down routine.
Right, yeah. And, but at the same time, I got to express basically what I wanted in 2 minutes. I only had about 2 minutes. And, The final statement that I made was that that yes, people in America are afraid of crime and they want something done, but more importantly, the people in America are becoming increasingly afraid of their own government, who will not support and defend constitutional principles upon which our country was founded in the first place. And then they switched off of me and went to Sarah Brady, and she got a little bit carried away. And she started claiming that this was nothing, that the five sheriffs nationwide who are suing the federal government about the Brady Bill are nothing but a bunch of pawns for the NRA, and that the NRA is telling them what to do, and that the NRA is backing them and paying their lawsuits. And then, to Charlie Gibson's credit, he corrected her and stopped her and said, well, he understood that the NRA was helping with some of the suits, but that he knew for a fact that the sheriff in Arizona, Sheriff Mack, was not receiving NRA funding, and that he was doing it on his own. And so that was one good thing, and I appreciated you doing that. And then Sarah Brady said something else that wasn't true. She said that the Brady Bill allows for the sheriff or the CLEOs, the chief law enforcement officers who are in charge of doing the background checks, that they are allowed to charge fees. And first of all, that is incorrect. Were you already aware of that?
No, I wasn't aware of it.
Yeah, there's nothing in the Brady Bill. See, and here she is getting $100,000 a year and trying to put the NRA down as one funding this, when she's making $100,000 a year by Gun Control Incorporated to be their spokesman.
Yeah.
And I find that totally hypocritical. But anyway, she was wrong, and at least Charlie Gibson pointed that out to her. But the other thing was is she's obviously not even read the bill that she's supporting and touting all over the country, because the bill does not allow for the charging of fees, and as a matter of fact, it is not lawful for sheriffs to charge a fee in the state of Arizona. That's why some of the other sheriffs who were not able to charge fees have turned it over to, for instance, in Pima County, they have Tucson PD doing the checks, Maricopa County, they're having Phoenix PD do the checks, because the cities can charge the fees, supposedly, and the sheriffs cannot.
Uh-huh.
So, no, there is no provision in the Brady Bill to charge fees, and I find it amazing that, first of all, we make a bill, I'm not going to say we, because there's nothing to do with me, I'm washing my hands of it, but it's amazing that the federal government will make what they call a law, and that will violate the constitutional rights of the citizens, and then turn around and say, and yes, we can charge the citizens for it while we do it. Well, that is just absolutely amazing. We're going to stop you and stop your rights and have you pay for it at the same time.
Well, you know, their concept of the American people is that we're just a bunch of stupid cattle and sheep. And I'll tell you, for a good many years, we've been proving them right, or we wouldn't be in this position. But I think,
and that's true. That's true. We the people have to take some responsibility in this, because our hands have been out to Washington D.C. asking for this and that, and asking them to take care of us, and allowing them to take care of us, and But it's also very gratifying, and I will tell you this honestly, Bill, since we last talked, and I'm going to tell you this, this has two parts to it. It has been extremely gratifying to me to see that there are a lot of people across this country that are not putting up with this and that are starting to wake up and saying, you know, Bill Cooper is right. Some of these other people that have these conservative talk shows are right. Some of this information that's coming out, they're right. It's time that we wake up. And they are waking up. And the reason I know that is because I have had literally thousands of letters and calls and messages and people stopping by. In fact, there was a man who stopped by Safford today. He went into the Chamber of Commerce and asked them where the sheriff was that was standing up for the Constitution, and they told him that I was right across the street. And he came in from Oregon on his way across other places. He decided to take a little detour and come to Safford and offer me his support and left me a check for $15 and said that he came here specifically just to shake my hand. He spent 5 minutes in my office, and I sure appreciated it. And there are a lot of people, and I'm going to the second part of that, what I was going to tell you is that I wouldn't be able to make it in this without the support. And I'm not talking about the monetary support. I'm talking about the people who have come by, who have called, who have given a positive word and said, keep going, Sheriff. Don't stop. We love you for what you're doing. It's tremendous. We thank you for having the courage to stand up for us. We're grateful that there's somebody that's an elected official that's standing up. And I'll be honest with you, Bill. If it wasn't for that, I wouldn't be able to do it. I'm not the type of person that is strong enough to go it alone. I'm just not. And if it wasn't for you and your listening audience and others, good, honest American citizens in my county, in the state of Arizona, and across this country, I wouldn't have made it. And that's the way I was in high school when I was playing sports and other, and since then, if I didn't have people that were able to lift me up and help me, my family, my mother and father, and others close to me, and good people around me, I wouldn't be able to make it. And this is what's been able to keep me going.
Well, I sure am happy to hear that that you have that support. Of course, we've tried to muster as much support for you as we possibly can. And I know up here in Apache County, over in St. John's, Tim Lesperance has a big jar in his restaurant collecting money to help you in your fight. And we're all spreading the word and passing out literature. And, of course, all the listeners to this show have written me letters expressing their desire to help in any way they can. There's a lot of us who know what team we're on.
Oh, yes.
And we do love you, and we know that you're on our team, and we're going to back you all the way.
Well, thanks, and it's been mutual, and I really appreciate it. You talk about the jars. I just got a call from somebody in the Larsons in Benson. Benson or Bisbee, I can't remember which one now. But anyway, it's in Cochise County, and they've been putting jars up in the different businesses of their own and others, and they've been collecting money, and they said they're going to come Monday and drop some of that money off to me. And it's just really tremendous to see people working together like this, and I sure do appreciate it.
Has anything happened court-wise, legally yet?
Yeah, that's also a really good question. What happened about a week ago, the federal government issued a memo, and it's really strange that they issue this memo and don't ever send it to anybody who it was intended for or who it talks about, the CLIOs, or the sheriffs who are responsible for, as they say, responsible for doing these background checks. Well, basically, this memo issued by Janet Reno's office, a legal advisor for Janet Reno, and I can't even remember his name right now. I think it's Wellinger, and Mr. Wellinger, and some other people were also quoted from the Justice Department office in this memo. And the only way I heard about it is that a reporter for the Associated Press from Washington, D.C. called me the day after this was released. I was it was on a Saturday, and I happened to be at the office doing paperwork, trying to catch up on the week's paperwork, and she calls me at the office and asked me if I was aware of it, and I said no. And she said, well, I'll send a send you a copy of our story. She didn't have a memo either, but she had spoken with some of these people and had some information, so she sent it to me. And otherwise, I have never received a copy of the memo. And the memo stated that the Justice Department says that it was obviously Congress's intent because of the vagueness and ambiguous language of the Brady Bill, that it was obviously Congress's intent to not force the sheriffs or the CLIOs to comply with the Brady Bill, and that they were obviously leaving it to the discretion of the sheriffs and CLIOs.
Yeah, well, they couldn't do that anyway. You're not under their jurisdiction. You don't work for them. You don't take orders from them.
Isn't that what I've been saying for the last 2 or 3 months?
That's right.
Since this thing came out. It quoted me exactly. And as a matter of fact, the AP story quoted what I said, and I said, well, isn't that what we've been saying all along? So anyway, and it said specifically that the Brady Bill did not provide the authority to the federal government to prosecute sheriffs or CLIOs who failed to comply with the Brady Bill. But they hoped now that the local police departments would still comply with the Brady provisions.
Well, it sounds like there's some smart sheriffs out there who, for political reasons, have turned it over to the police departments to handle.
Oh, sure.
And when it comes election time, they can say, hey, it's not me. I'm not doing the checks.
Yeah.
But they're really, they're performing sort of a cowardly act, don't you think?
Well, yeah. Yeah, and I think they all, you know, especially every sheriff in the state said that they disagreed with this bill and that it won't work and it's wrong for one reason or the other, for one reason or another. And it bothers me that they won't come out publicly and say that instead of just a closed meeting. And I believe that it's time for elected officials to stand up and be counted, and especially people that are representing the body of the people, and officials that are representing the people of this country need to stand up instead of just wishy-washy talk. And I'm getting a little bit tired of that, to be honest with you.
Oh, me too. And everybody's going to have to make a choice pretty soon. You know, militia units are forming all over this country.
Yeah.
Were you aware of that?
Yes, I was. I've received calls from a lot of them.
Yeah, we have a strong militia up here, very strong militia. Just about 2 weeks ago, up in Montana, they had a militia meeting. 600 people showed up, and it's all over the place. I'm constantly receiving letters from people telling me what they're doing, and in one way, it's really scary. In another way, it really gives me a lot of hope for the future.
Yeah, it does me too. Well, we had a. Do you have to break for commercials on this show? I can't remember.
Yeah, I got a break at about the 30 mark, which is about 7 more minutes. So.
Well, another thing that happened Saturday, it was terrible weather, but a lot of the local gun clubs down here, especially the Mount Graham Gun Club, organized a fundraiser shoot and asked all the interested parties to come, and there was quite a few people, but Saturday, if you'll recall, was the worst weather we've had in this month.
Uh-huh.
And so it wasn't as good a turnout as we wanted, but they still raised about $1,600 in one day. So that was tremendous. That's the most I've ever received in one day from any type of donation. And so I was thrilled with that, but one thing that happened that's really interesting, I think your listeners are going to like this, Tokyo Broadcasting out of New York, there's a broadcast company that only airs news to Japan, came out to Arizona and did a story about what was going on with this Brady Bill fight in Safford, Arizona.
Well, that's wonderful.
Oh, you're not a kid. I was thrilled. And here I had an opportunity to speak to all the people of Japan about freedom, about government by for and of the people, and the reporter, his name was Toshio, didn't speak very good English, but we got enough to communicate, and he basically asked me the one question, why you have guns? Why so many guns in America? Why you have guns? Why guns so important? And I said, guns are so important in America because without them we would not be a free country today. And the difference between Japan and America is that in Japan, The way it's set up is that the government runs the people. And the way it's supposed to be in America is that the people run the government. And the ultimate power and the most powerful part of our government in America is the people. They bestow all power. They bestow all authority. And they are the ones with the final say-so. And if you take away our guns, you take away our power. If you take away our guns, you take away our final say-so. So when we have the guns, we have the power and the will and the capability of making the final decision as to what will happen in our own government. And it also gives us the power to protect ourselves against criminal elements. And for instance, nothing has made this more vivid than the two Japanese students who were just recently killed in, what was it, L.A.?
I don't remember. I remember the story, though.
It just came out, and I was watching part of it tonight. I think it was the L.A. area. Yes, it was, because I remember seeing the Los Angeles police chief talking about it this evening on the news. So, and here again, what I told him is that if you were going down the street in New York and you were with your wife and there was two or three criminals that wanted to attack you, take your money, and rape your wife, what would you be able to do about it if you didn't have a gun? On the other hand, if you had a gun, you would be able to defend yourself and your wife and maintain your personal peace and safety. I said, in Japan, the big payoff is that you do live in a more nonviolent society than America does. I says, but if we will get our act together here in America, we will also conquer that problem. But I said, on the other hand, in America, the police do not have the authority to come in my home anytime they want, like they do in Japan. They do not have the authority to come in my home and check to see if I have a gun. They do not have the authority to throw me in jail for 10 years for having a gun. And he told me that's what could happen to him. And I talked him in at the shoot. He came out to watch that. I talked him into shooting a gun for the first time in his life. For the first time in his life, and he's 38 years old, he touched a gun for the first time. And he shot a gun. And Channel 12 also showed him shooting the gun. And it was an amazing story. And I will never forget when this humble Oriental man finally said goodbye to me. He said, Sheriff, please, one more time, let me please ask you, I no get arrested for shooting a gun today? Yeah. And I was so touched by him, and I said, no, you're not going to be arrested. I said, this is America. And I said, Toshio, did you see anything wrong happening out there today? And there was probably 5,000 rounds of bullets fired out there that day.
Uh-huh.
Guns blazing the whole time. There was three different shoots going on at the same time. There was probably 100 different shooters and all sorts of different guns. And I said, did you see anybody get hurt? No. Did you see anything go wrong? No. Weren't these good, honest, friendly people out there today? Oh, yes, he had a wonderful time, and he thanked me and thanked me. In fact, their business, their company called me just yesterday and thanked me again for our hospitality and showing everybody, their reporter and cameraman, such a good time. And I said, that's what America is about, being able to go and do things without governmental interference, going and shooting and having a good time, not hurting anybody, not violating anybody's rights, but just having a good, honest American time.
Fantastic. You know, I think that memo that the Justice Department sent out,
yeah.
I have a feeling that was meant to appease the sheriffs and maybe appease you into dropping your suit and going back about your business. But if it's a deception like that, or if it's meant to be a sort of a bribe, you know, throwing, well, you really don't have to do this. We're not going to tell the other sheriffs, Mr. Mack, but we'll tell you, you really don't have to do this if you don't want to.
Well, I'll tell you, you're right online, and it took me about a day to figure out the ploy that this memo really was. And if you want to get into that after the break, we will, because I think it's going to take quite a while to maybe address that and tell you exactly why I know this memo was not honest in its approach.
Uh-huh. So you're not going to take the bait, and you're going to stick to the constitutional issue, which is the real issue.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I did get one call from a reporter and say, hey, you know, and this got a lot of press when that memo came out.
Uh-huh.
And the local paper down here said Sheriff Mack is elated over the latest ruling from the the Justice Department. Well, first of all, it's an opinion. It's a legal opinion, and legal opinions are no different than any other opinion. Everybody has one, and it doesn't mean a dang thing.
Uh-huh.
And anybody can give their opinion, and my opinion is that as long as the Brady Bill's on paper, it's dangerous and can be used against me.
Yes, sir.
So, but...
Folks, as you listen to this broadcast, as you listen to Sheriff Mack, as you listen to my program the other night, on all of the gun legislation bills that are in the House and in the Senate at the present time, and as I read to you the words of Sarah Brady and Handgun Control Incorporated, in their confidential memo, which we came into possession of, I'm sure that you have been forced to look around and take stock of what are you going to do? What are you going to do if it comes down to buckling under and marching into slavery in the New World Order, or standing up to protect the freedoms that so many Americans have died to give to us and to protect over all of the years since this nation was founded, since the Declaration of Independence was penned by our forefathers, since the Constitution and the Bill of Rights were written and became the supreme law of the land? Do you have any idea? Have you thought about how many people have given their lives so that we could remain free and enjoy the fruits of the labor, the efforts, the sacrifices that all who've gone before us brought about? I want you to do that tonight, because very shortly, as you already know, everyone's going to have to make a choice, because it's going to come down to that. They have named 1994 as the year that they're going to take the guns away from the American people. And we're not very far from it happening right this moment. Now, the Constitution forbids them to do that, forbids them to break down our doors in the middle of the night and search our homes without any kind of a warrant or criminal charges. But we know, those of us who are watching and paying attention, that it's already happening across the nation right this moment. That people's homes are being broken into in the dead of night, searched, trashed. Have you ever seen a home after it's been searched? Trashed is the proper word for it. Their property is confiscated. Their cars are seized. Their children are taken from them. Their property can be literally auctioned off within a 24-hour period. It has happened to many, many, many people. Charges never filed, and they haven't a prayer of getting their property back. What do you think this is all about, folks? You'd better start giving some serious thought. And those of you who didn't listen to me and have really been losing money in this stock market drop, and it's not finished, I can assure you, it's going to go lower. You'd better take stock now. You need to prepare for the worst and pray that the worst never comes. It's better to be prepared for the worst never come, than have it happen and not be prepared at all. So call our sponsors, Swiss America Trading. Do it now, 1-800-289-2646. Do it right now, ladies and gentlemen. 1-800-289-2646. Thank them for sponsoring the Hour of the Time. Mention my name, William Cooper, and ask for the newsletters and the written material that you, as listeners to the Hour of the Time, are entitled. And ask them about ways to protect your assets. Protect your assets. Now, if you're interested in finding an investment where you're going to make a killing, forget it. That's not what we're about here. Do it. 1-800-289-2646. And do it right now. Folks, the Wild West is not gone, and the spirit of the West is not gone. It's still alive in many of us. The ideals and principles upon which this country was based are not dead. They are not gone. And they are not a bunch of silly ideas pinned by a bunch of doddering old men 200 years ago who didn't understand the complexities of the modern world. The Constitution is a living Constitution. It provides within it the method whereby it can be changed if we, the people, believe that it needs to be changed. And so far, we have not allowed it. Therefore, it does not need it. What do you have to say about that, Sheriff Mack?
Well, we need to get back, as you were saying, we need to get back to the basics. We need to get back to that basic spirit of freedom that existed at the time our country was founded back in 1776. We need to understand that these principles are eternal. God-given principles, they're divinely inspired, our Constitution was divinely inspired, and we need to understand that those principles don't change. There's a lot of people saying, well, yeah, America is so much more advanced than it was in 1776, in the time of the Constitutional Conventions, and the ideas passed on from Alexander Hamilton and Patrick Henry and Thomas Jefferson and George Washington. We're good at that time, but America has seen a new day, and we need new ideas. No, that is completely stupid thinking. We cannot abandon our past and think that we're going to form some sort of future by going to these social programs and socialism and Marxist ideas. Those ideas have always been here, controlling the masses, and gun control has always been here, and we have got to learn from our past if we're going to prepare for a future. And the best way is by what you were just saying, making sure that we keep this spirit of America freedom, waving on our own personal flags and carry this banner with us wherever we go.
I think we need to educate Americans that gun control really does work. It really does work. Hitler proved it.
Sure.
Stalin proved it.
Cuba.
Castro proved it.
Yeah.
Mao Zedong proved it.
Yes.
And socialism, everywhere it's been tried on this earth, has always resulted in failure.
Yes.
And democracy is a code word for socialist. This is a republic, and people forget that. They're buying into these buzzwords that the socialists use to help bend them to their will and give up their will, actually.
And Abraham Lincoln couldn't have said it any better, and I think his Gettysburg Address is probably the best definition of what our country is really about. And he said it, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom.
And shall not perish from the earth.
That government by foreign of the people shall not perish from the earth.
Right.
And nothing was absolutely more applicable to our day than his 2.5 minute speech.
You know, it's amazing. You know, I just played that the other night.
To see what Abraham Lincoln, how inspired he was, even though it was the Civil War and the Battle of Gettysburg that touched his heart so much, for him to be inspired to understand at that point, with all the strife he must have been going through, and for him to be in tune with the Lord enough to understand that this really was the definition of what our government was all about. And I sure admire him for that speech.
Me too. The same people killed him, I believe, that killed John F. Kennedy.
Yes.
And the symbology is all there. The connections were all there. What next? What do you do next now?
Well, as I was saying before the break, this memo put out by the Justice Department turns out that it was merely a ploy to gain some courtroom positioning, and because the memo was followed up by a courtroom brief to the judge stating in about a 20-page memo, or in a 20-page brief signed by about 10 different attorneys for the federal government, that now Sheriff Mack, or the other sheriffs, specifically me in this case, because that's where it was filed, is in the district court in Tucson where I filed my lawsuit, that I no longer have any standing to sue.
I guess you don't have any constitutional rights, therefore this is not going to affect your constitutional rights.
First of all, they say, the sheriff has to do this. Well, we're not going to force the sheriff to do it, so the sheriff can't say no, the sheriff can't sue us, and the Brady Bill stands. Now everybody go back to work, and Sheriff, leave us alone, you little boy. And so what they're basically saying is that we said we wouldn't force the sheriff to do it, so he can't sue us. Why is he crying? He can't sue us now. We said we wouldn't force him.
Mm-hmm.
We said we wouldn't prosecute him.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now he has no standing. So tell the sheriff to go home and leave us alone. So that's what's being argued right now. But at the same time, after discussing this with my attorney, he agrees that that's what the memo was for. He agrees that it was just a ploy. And like I said, it took me about a day to figure that out.
Mm-hmm.
Because at first I was happy when I first saw it. I go, oh, golly, you know, that's great. And then right after I go, okay, what's going on here? And then about the next day, I started figuring out, they're attacking my standing to be able to sue.
Mm-hmm.
And sure enough, when I saw that brief, my attorney sent me a copy of the brief. And he says, yeah, he says, Mac, you're right. That's what it was. And so now, the judge has not ruled on that yet. And I really doubt if this is going to win for him, because we have filed another brief counteracting it, stating that the law is there. It's still on the books. Sheriff Mack is the CLEO, as described in the Brady Bill. He is the one responsible for doing those checks, whether they say they will prosecute or not. It still says on the law that the sheriff could go to jail for not doing it. He could be fined for not doing it. And basically, that he still has a fundamental belief that it does not serve the needs of the people who elected him.
Now, how does the suit read? Exactly what are you suing them for?
Okay, and actually the suit does not mention the Second Amendment, because, plain and simply, my attorney said that would be laughed at, because there are so many cases where the Supreme Court has ruled against the Second Amendment that it would be a waste of time in court to rehash stuff that the Supreme Court has already said isn't against the Second Amendment.
I think you should go talk to your attorney. We've researched all the Supreme Court rulings on the Second Amendment, and that's just not true.
Well,
in fact, the Supreme Court has ruled that any weapons that could be used or should be used by the militia cannot be tampered with, regulated, registered, or anything else.
Well, I'd appreciate seeing that, because I am aware of also some others. In fact, I've seen several cases where it goes both ways, and I do admit it has gone both ways, and that's why I think there's a lot of ambiguity about that. But I would love to see any documentation on that, because my attorney is a Second Amendment specialist.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote a book on the Second Amendment. He agrees that it is a violation of the Second Amendment, and in fact, the name of his book is The Origins and Development of the Second Amendment.
Mm-hmm.
It goes way back to like 1200. AD.
I can never figure out why people don't argue the case with the militia in hand, because the second article amendment specifically states a militia being necessary to the
security
of a free state, the right of the people keeping their arms shall not be infringed.
Right.
So they always point to this militia thing. Well, the law says that there is an organized militia. In the federal law, it states that the organized militia is the National Guard.
Sure.
But it also states there's an unorganized militia, and it consists of every man or boy between the ages of 17 45. And 45. Now, that's the federal government. The state of Arizona says every man and boy between the ages of 17 and 45. And they're expected to own a weapon and be able to muster on a moment's notice and fight to protect the state.
Right.
So any regulation of weapons that could be used by the militia is, to me, would be the best argument to use, although the principal clause of the second article in amendment is the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed.
Right.
The United States Senate in 1981, I believe it was, ruled, passed a resolution of the Senate that specifically stated that the militia is not the military, is not the National Guard, but consists of the whole people.
Right. Yeah, and
so they even included women and all ages.
Right. And well, the power of the sheriff to call a posse states in ARS Code 11-441 that the sheriff has the power,
mm-hmm.
to command every able-bodied person within the confines of the county where he is sheriff to command all able-bodied citizens to his aid in enforcing the law.
Well, I got real big news for these people. There are too many of us that are not going to give up our weapons, period. We're just not going to do it. I don't care what laws they pass. I don't care what they say. It's unconstitutional. It's against the Constitution of the United States of America. It's against the Arizona State Constitution and most of the constitutions that I've ever seen in this country of any state.
Right. In any state. That's right. And then I, you know, even as much as yesterday, I still get another letter to the editor in the local paper here from a lady who says, Sheriff, I admit that the Brady Bill is a feeble attempt to help us, but it's designed to help us and protect us. And you should be upholding the law. And I'm sitting here saying, my gosh, I'm supposed to uphold this law and forget the Constitution, which is the supreme law of the land, forget my oath of office so I can help Sarah Brady enforce this little token symbolism to feel sorry for what happened to her husband. And I'll be honest with you, Bill, I do feel sorry for her husband. I am sorry that he got shot. I'm sorry that President Reagan got shot. But I'm also sorry for these other victims across the country who weren't able to defend themselves because they weren't able to arm themselves. And if plain and simply, the bottom line is, if more people carried guns, there'd be fewer of us getting shot.
I think more people should study history. These same socialists who want to take over the United States and aim us into a socialist New World Order, into the totalitarian socialist United Nations charter that has no Bill of Rights, no individual rights for anyone, these are the same socialists who brought about the Bolshevik Revolution, who created the Soviet Union. These are the same socialists who created communist Cuba. These are the same socialists who, throughout the world, have first risen to power on the promise that they're going to give the people what they need, and then the first thing they do is disarm the people and enslave them. They've done it throughout history, and they're going to do it to us.
Right. Before we got up on the Second Amendment, you asked what the grounds of my suit were, and the other one was, the other main areas, and I think this is as important, or if not more so, and probably is more important than the Second Amendment, and that is that, plain and simply, the federal government does not have the jurisdictional authority to tell me or any other sheriff in this country that we have to enforce federal law.
You're absolutely correct.
And if they would simply butt out, the Second Amendment would be fine. But they won't, and so we're suing on the Ninth and Tenth Amendments about states' rights and the limitations the Constitution puts on the government in being able to intervene in local and state affairs. And then we also are suing on the 13th Amendment, which states that slavery, the outlawed slavery, and involuntary servitude.
Mm-hmm.
Here again, the federal government is telling me I have to serve them without just compensation, without an agreement, without a contract, and I'm not going to work for them because, first of all, I work for the people of Graham County, and if I am forced to work for them by either saying I will be fined or imprisoned, that's a form of slavery, and it definitely is involuntary servitude.
What are you going to do, Sheriff? Have you thought about what you're going to do if you lose this?
Yes, I've thought about a lot of different things on that. First of all, there are some. There's another thing that we're suing for, and that is that I have had two deputies tell me that they would not enforce the Brady Bill if I asked them to. And
right.
Now I have a disciplinary matter to address because it does state in Arizona law that a sheriff or department head, a police chief, cannot ask an employee to do something, or a deputy or a sheriff or a deputy or a police officer does not have to comply with an order from his chief or sheriff if it is unlawful.
Well, that's what Nuremberg was all about.
What's that?
Nuremberg, where they tried the Nazi war criminals after World War II.
Oh, yes.
It, for the first time in history, they made the decision in international law that you could be tried for war crimes even if you had been ordered to commit those crimes by your superior officers.
Yes. Yeah.
So the fact that it's illegal takes precedence over whatever your supervisor might do to punish you.
Exactly. And that's right in the law, because I've gone before these commissions before where employees have filed grievances against me. It's been very seldom. But it states there in the law that they have to do what I say unless my order is arbitrary or capricious or unlawful. And they do not have to comply with my orders if they're unlawful. I've had two employees tell me they would not do it.
Well, I would hope that you would never issue such orders, and I would certainly back them if they didn't.
Oh, me too. And so now I have a disciplinary matter, and so then if they take this and have to go with it, then they file a grievance and say, sorry, Sheriff, we won't do it. And so then it will then be documented and on the book stating that, and I will agree with them, you know.
Uh-huh. So you'll be on the books too.
I'll be on the books stating that they're right, that they're filing this grievance, and that they don't have to do it.
Well, America's going to have to draw the line somewhere, and it might as well.
And I was really proud of these two deputies for coming and telling me. In fact, I had one of them in my office today.
Well, I wasn't aware that this had happened. I'm very proud of them, too, and I wish that this would begin to happen across the country. I know it won't happen to most police forces because they choose their officers by a psychological profile that guarantees that they're going to do what they tell them to do.
Well, and that's another thing, and I hope there's a police officers listening to this, and I want to tell every police officer in this country, as I've told others, you do not work for your sergeant, you do not work for your chief of police, you do not work for your sheriff. You work more for your sheriff than a deputy works more for a sheriff than any other police agency, because that's the way the system was set up.
What's an elected post?
A deputy is an extension of the sheriff, and that's what deputy means. You are acting in my stead. So, but at the same time, you do not work for your sheriff, your chief, or your sergeant, or your captain. You work for the people, and that's what you have sworn to do. And you are supervised by a captain and a sergeant and a chief who are supposed to be teaching you constitutional principles on the way to perform your duties as a servant of the people. And your primary function is to make sure that the rights of the people for whom you work and who pay your salary, that those rights are secured and never violated, especially by an officer of the law.
Well, it's so refreshing to hear that. As we study what police officers are being taught in major cities across this country, we find two things that are very disturbing. One, they're told that the public, the people that they work for, are the enemy. And they are told not to associate with anyone who's not a police officer. Are you aware of that? That's incredible.
I'm not aware that they're told to associate with only police officers, but I am aware of the other part in some instances.
Yeah.
In some instances, I know it has happened. They're trained that anybody out there could do a man any time, and that they're supposed to be on the guard that anybody they see could be a potential enemy. Yes, I've heard that before.
Well, we've come to a sad situation in this country.
Beyond
the other night, I issued the Sheriff Mack, and we're just about out of time. So,
okay.
I issued a call to arms, and I called for everybody in this country to form militia units and get ready. To make a decision whether or not they're going to give up their arms or whether they're going to support the Constitution and save this country from its final decline. I sincerely believe that when the last gun leaves the last hand of the last honest American, it will be the last day of freedom on not just the American continent, but the whole world.
Oh, yes.
I sincerely believe that. I want to thank you for all that you've done. We support you. And once again, I'm going to ask my listeners to send contributions. And if you'll, well, I'll tell you what. I'll give the address to send it to tomorrow night on the hour of the time. So everybody be listening and have your pen and paper. We're out of time. Thank you very much, Sheriff Mack. And we wish you well. And remember, we're all with you all the time.
Thanks so much.
Good night.
Good night.
And good night, folks. God bless you all.
Bring the sunny weather. Happy trails.